Hello everybody, it's me, ASMR Cat. I hope your day is going great. I have some tingles in store for you. I have the next bit of Green Angel by Alice Hoffman here. And I hope y'all enjoy. So relax and listen. The next part of the book is called
as cold as silver in my dreams, but she was as real to me as the
blueberries that grew in the woods, all the blueberries, all the raspberries. I had found wild asparagus and made soups in the black pot I kept on the fire I left burning in the stove. My hands were rough from chopping wood, from gathering asparagus in the marshes, from collecting the few berries that had been singed black from the heat across the river. There were very few tins left in the pantry. No flour, no salt, and my stomach went out growling, wanting me to stay alive. I decided to go into town, but I was no fool. I took precautions. I wore my leather jacket, my clothes with thorns, my heavy boots, which I had hammered to half a dozen nails. I carried my stones and my slingshot. I was ready for looters, wild men, highway robbers. I expected almost anything. But when I left the woods for the main thoroughfare, all that greeted me was an unnatural silence. There used to be traffic. There were trains that ran on an hour, racing across the silver bridge into the city. Now that bridge had all but melted into the heat of this from the city. It was closed, a thick rope tied across the entrance. People stayed close to home, worried about what might await them in the open road. There used to be children heading to the river to swim on hot days. Now there was no one. There used to be bicyclists, carts, and farmers on their way into town on a monthly market. Now there was nothing but the dust I kicked into the air with every step I took. My sister's dog had followed me. He snarled at the few strangers lurking about. Pets left to fend for themselves when their owners failed to return home. On one corner were two dead ravens, their feathers thick with ash. The palm trees that had lined the road were leafless, bark gray. When I passed the church just outside the village, there was a sign printed with the names of everyone who had been lost. One after another, mothers and fathers, sons and daughters. I was amazed at how many there were, but not surprised to see my name among them. The girl that I had been, the one called Green, they were right about her. She was gone. The shopkeeper at the general store stared hard when he saw me. He didn't know who I was, with my short hair and my black ink and the nails in my shoes. He reached for the glove he kept near his money box, ready to fight me off if I need be. Even after I told him I was my parents' daughter, he didn't seem to believe me. He spoke to me from a distance, keeping the counter between us, as if he was conversing with a dead ghost. "Everyone said you were dead," he insisted. I didn't dispute this. I didn't say these people were wrong. I just took what I brought to trade out my backpack and held it up to the light. The shopkeeper noticed my cloudy eyes. He could tell that I was half blind, and perhaps this was why he tried to cheat me. He told me the ring I had was copper, but I knew it was gold. My mother had kept this ring in a bowl on her dresser, and I had played with it ever since I was a baby. I knew what I held in my hands. Pure sunlight, pure gold. I laughed at the idea that my mother's most valued piece of jewelry was copper. The sound of my voice frightened the shopkeeper and stepped even further away. He didn't know what to expect from me, but one thing was certain. I wasn't shy anymore. I wasn't that quiet, moody girl Green whom anyone could fool. I was the girl who could touch the earth and gauge where the river was. I was the one who could feel sorrow in the wind. I knew gold was heavy, copper warm, and the silver candlesticks I brought forth in my backpack felt like ice. "I suppose you're going to tell me these are deer antlers," I said, of the candlesticks, which had been cast by one of the finest silversmiths in the cities. "I know what I have," I told the shopkeeper. "I expect to be paid well." That was the last of any arguments at the general store. As a matter of fact, the shopkeeper called for his wife, who came to watch me with narrowed eyes as if I was a circus act or a charlatan. "Green," the shopkeeper's wife said uncertainly. She'd known my family quite well and had often bought vegetables from my mother. But in the world we now lived in, why should she trust me any more than I trusted her? Why shouldn't she gawk at the nail? I could identify silver and gold, what else might I know? Sure enough, I could tell green tea from black, navy beans from kidney beans, earth from ashes, honesty from deceit. I have another talent, it seemed, one that made people nervous.